I welcome everyone to our leaders' development meeting today in Jesus' name. And I pray that the Lord will develop every one of us. We're going from strength to strength and from faith to faith. You'll not be the same again like you came in Jesus' name. Something must be added to your life tonight. Am I talking to somebody there? That's you there. God bless you. Father, we thank you for our leadership development tonight. Thank you for your people, your servants, our leaders. Thank you for the preachers of the word. And thank you for the great assignment before us. We're asking, Lord, you energize everyone tonight in Jesus' name. Empower your people. Send us forth with courage, with conviction, with consecration, and with the word that cannot fail. And we pray that your power will move through every life in Jesus' name. This weekend, Lord, we pray as your people stand for the truth, and they declare the truth, and they preach the word of God without fear and without favor, multitudes will come into the kingdom in Jesus' name. Lord, lay your hand on everyone. On the preachers, lay your hand. On the choir, lay your hand. On our electronics people, lay your hand upon them. Usher, security, lay your hand upon them. And all the women, all the youths, lay your hands upon them. Even from this moment, publicity, prayer, everything going on, Lord, you are going to use everything to usher souls into the kingdom in Jesus' name. Lord, give us clear weather. And we pray that even the heavens, the sky spiritually, will be cleared of everything disturbing in Jesus' name. It will be a glorious time, a powerful time. Confirm it in every life, in every location, in every church, in every district, in every group, and all our brethren all over Nigeria, Africa, they'll feel the impact of your word in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Give me an amen that shows you are getting ready. God bless you. You can sit down. As we all know at the headquarters church that is here in Lagos, this weekend, Friday, Saturday and Sunday, September 1st, 2nd and 3rd, we're having a city-wide crusade, a state-wide crusade. Every corner, every section of this state will know that Christ is alive. Well, that Jesus is our Savior. And we're asking that all the other states, if you have not planned anything like that, you'll plan something like this, that the headquarters is planning for this weekend. Multitudes are going to come into the kingdom. But please let us understand, it's not only the preachers that are holding the crusades. All of us are holding the crusades together. You're praying, you're ushering, you're doing whatever, you're singing. Let everything we do contribute to something positive, progressive, and practical in this weekend crusade. It will happen in Jesus' name. And as God is choosing the preachers, He'll use all of us. As God is blessing people through them, He'll bless people through you in Jesus' name. How many of us are going to be profitable this weekend? Serviceable this weekend? And God is going to use you. And He'll add a star to your crown in Jesus' name. Tonight we have looked at the Trinity of the Godhead. And then this weekend we're looking forward to the evangelization of our communities. How do you put all that together? Tonight I'm talking to you on the Trinitarian challenge. From the triune God. It's a triune God. Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Three in one. The plurality of the Godhead. And yet the unity of the Godhead. That's why it's a triune God. Three, but united. And yet it's God. The Father is God. The Son is God. The Holy Ghost is God. And now we have a Trinitarian challenge. That is a challenge coming from the Father, a challenge coming from the Son, a challenge coming from the Holy Ghost. In 1 John chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 7. 1 John chapter 5, verse 7. For there are three that bear record in heaven. It's not talking about angels, it's not talking about men, it's not talking about the saints, it's talking about God himself. And it says three bearing record in heaven. One, the Father. Two, the Word. Remember, the Word as Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then it says, and the Holy Ghost. Three. And it says, and these three are, tell me everybody, one. You see the plurality there, and you see the unity there. And as we talk about our salvation, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, as we talk about sending us forth to evangelize by the Father, by the Son, by the Holy Ghost, it tells us in John chapter 3. And we're looking at verse 16, John chapter 3, verse 16. It talks about the Father here and the Son. It says, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. You can see that there's a distinction between the Father and the Son. It's not the Father sending himself, but it says God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And when he sent the only begotten Son, the Son was on earth and the Father remained in heaven. So you will see that we have distinct personalities. But it says, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. In 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 14. 1 John chapter 4, verse 14. It says, and we have seen and do testify that the Father, that's God the Father, that's a distinct personality, that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And so you see that the Father is interested and he desires the salvation of the world. And he sent his only begotten Son. We're seeing God the Father there. And we're seeing his involvement. We're seeing his action. We're seeing his plan concerning our salvation. We're looking at John chapter 17. John chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 18. As thou hast sent me into the world, that's the Son talking to the Father, even so have I also sent them into the world. It says the Father used his authority and he sent me, and I'm also exercising my authority and I'm sending the disciples. We have the same power, the same authority, and we have the same passion for the salvation of the world. We're looking at John chapter 20. We're reading from verse 21. John chapter 20, verse 21. It tells us, then said Jesus unto them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. You understand? The Father desires the salvation of the world, and therefore he sent the Son. And the Son has the same passion, the same compassion, the same love. Now he has sent us, his disciples, his followers, for the salvation of the world. The Father is involved in soul winning. The Father is involved in sending us forth that will preach the gospel. And the Son is involved, and the Son is interested, and the Son is passionate, and the Son is also sending us forth for the preaching of the gospel. But now the Holy Ghost, Acts of the Apostles chapter 13, and we're reading from verse 4. Acts chapter 13, verse 4. So they, being sent forth by the Holy Ghost, you see that? The Father sends us forth. The Son sends us forth, and the Holy Ghost sends forth. It says that they departed to Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. So you understand that this challenge and this commission and this going forth is by the triune God. The Trinitarian challenge from the triune God. God created the world and is not willing that any should perish. God the Father desires and he demands that all should hear the gospel and have the opportunity to be saved. He commands the preaching of the gospel. Obedience is rewardable, disobedience is punishable. Not only that, Christ died for the whole world. He has paid the great price of redemption for all on earth. He has commanded us to preach the gospel to every creature. Faithfulness is rewardable, unfaithfulness is punishable. Not only that, the Holy Ghost has empowered the church to take the whole world, the whole world, to the whole world. He confirms the call. He directs the great work of evangelizing the world. Commitment is rewardable. Carelessness or careless indifference is punishable. And so tonight, we look at the charge. Tonight, we look at the challenge. Tonight, we look at the commandment, the Trinitarian challenge from the triune God. There are three things we're looking at. One, concerning the Father. Two, concerning the Son. Three, concerning the Holy Ghost. Number one, the preeminent compassion of God the Father. The preeminent compassion of God the Father. Number two, the predominant commission by God the Son. The predominant commission by God the Son. Number three, the prevailing confirmation of God the Holy Ghost. The prevailing confirmation of God the Holy Ghost. Number one, the preeminent compassion of God the Father. You see, the Father who created the whole world and all the people in the world, his desire, his concern, his love is that all should be saved. And because of that, since he wants all to be saved, he sends forth people to reach out to all people so that they can be saved. In 2 Peter chapter 3, talking about God the Father. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards world, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. If you left it in the hand of God alone, were it not for the fact that the will of man is involved, that the faithfulness of the church is involved, were it not for the fact that there are people that resist the gospel, were it not for the fact that people have their own volition, their own free will, and their own choice, if God were to handle it all alone by himself, he'll want everyone to be saved. The same thing you can say about Israel coming out of Egypt and going to the land of Canaan. Were it not for the fact that men had their free will and their volition, and that they could make a choice, and God did not want to make them like robots, and he said, I put before you life and death, choose life that you may live. Were it not for the fact that they had a choice to make, and he put that in their hands, if you left it in the hands of God alone, he'll take every one of them and put every one of them in the land of Canaan. The same thing, he wants us all to get to heaven. He's not willing that anybody should perish. He wants all to come to repentance. That's why he has done what he has done. What did he do? 1 John chapter 4 verse 14. 1 John chapter 4 verse 14. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of who? of the world, the whole world. He wants all the world to be saved. God is a God of love. God is a God of mercy. God is a God of compassion. And he drew the plan of salvation. And he sent his only begotten Son to sacrifice and to save all his creatures. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world, the whole world. If you left it in his hand alone, he'll save everyone. And that's why he has sent us forth. And he says we shouldn't overlook anyone. We shouldn't brush aside anyone. We should make this salvation available, eternal life available for everyone. He now calls and he now commands to seek the lost. That's what he's telling us. The Father is telling every one of his children in his family, seek the lost. He's telling us, rescue the perishing. He's telling us, warn all sinners. He's telling us, preach repentance. He's telling us, persuade men to turn and to believe. He's telling us, prevail on your neighbors with love. Have compassion on the ignorant and turn them from sin, from darkness, from hell, and turn them towards the Savior, towards light, and towards heaven. I pray we'll obey God. I will obey God. If you look at John again, John chapter 3, reading from verse 16 and verse 16, you see the action of God, purposeful action. You see the action of God, the preeminent action above every other sin. It tells us in chapter 3 of John, verse 16, for God so loved the world. It will be enough to say he loved the world, but not just that he loved the world ordinarily. Not that he loved the world superficially. Not that he loved the world moderately. He so loved the world extraordinarily. He so loved the world sacrificially. He so loved the world passionately. He so loved the world that he gave the best he had in heaven. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, you see that there's no discrimination there. God wants everyone, whosoever, to come out of sin, come to the Savior, come out of darkness, come to the light, and come out of evil, and come into the grace of God, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. His heart is large enough to accommodate everyone. His love is large enough to accommodate everyone. And his mercy, compassion is large enough to take in everyone. His heaven is big enough to take everyone. And so there's no discrimination. That's why it says in verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. Look at his mercy. The world was condemned. Condemnable, and the world is still condemnable. The world was evil. Evil is condemnable. And the world is sinful. Sinful people are condemnable. And yet he will not send his world to go and judge them, to go and consign them to hell, and to go and condemn them. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him, tell me, might be saved, might be saved. And if you're a child of God, like father, like children, he wants you to have his nature. He wants you to have his love. He wants you to have his compassion. He wants this compassion to be preeminent in your heart, that this is the thing you're living for, that you don't want any of your neighbors, any of your acquaintances, any of your friends, any of your office colleagues to perish. You want them to come into life eternal. See what God has done. Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 26. Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 26. It says, unto you first, God, that's him, unto you first, God, having raised up his Son from the dead, having raised up his Son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away, how many people? every one of you from his iniquities. Let's read that with understanding. You know, sometimes when you have this comma here, that comma there, it means that you can omit that inside the comma. So just look at the commas there as a bracket. Open the bracket, close the bracket, remove that bracket first. Look at this. Unto you first, God sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. You know, if God had his way, no Israelite will perish. If God had his way, all the Israelites will be saved, because God so loved them that first he thought about them. He said they were the sons and the children of Abraham. Therefore God first sent his son to them to turn them away from their iniquity and to turn them unto the Lord so that they will not perish. How did he do that? He did that through Jesus Christ. Look at verse 26 now. Unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him, Jesus, to bless you, not to hurt you, to bless you, not to judge you, to bless you, not to damn you, to bless you, not to condemn you, to bless you, not to curse you, to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. That's the Father. That's God the Father. He so loves the world, and he wants us to go and tell them. The Father doesn't want us to just sit idle or to fold our hands or to shut our mouths and say, well, if they want to go to heaven, they have a Bible. He says, go and tell them. Somebody told you, and he said, love your neighbor as yourself. If something good came to you and you have your neighbor and you love him as yourself, look at hell there. They're going to hell. And he says, would you want to go to hell? No, sir. That's why I got saved. Okay, you don't want to get to hell. Love him as you love yourself and go and tell him. You cannot say, I'm just a young man, I cannot do it. You have neighbors, love your neighbors. I'm a woman, I cannot do it. You have neighbors, love your neighbors. I'm a youth, I cannot do it. You have neighbors, love your neighbors. I'm just a child, I cannot do it. And you're born again and you're saved. You have neighbors, love your neighbors as yourself and tell them what you would have wanted others to tell you if you were not saved and they were saved. The Father wants them saved. They'll get saved. I said they'll get saved. Through you, there are people that will hear the good news of salvation and they will come to the Lord in Jesus' name. This idea of getting people saved, was it an afterthought that God wanted to save only the Israelites? But after, he said, okay, let me think about the Gentiles. Not an afterthought at all. Acts of the Apostles, I'm reading from chapter 15, verse 7. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 15, verse 7. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago, God, who is making the plan here, tell me out loud, God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. He said, don't you remember all this argument we are having about the Gentiles, that God called me and God sent me to those Gentiles so that they will hear the word of the gospel and believe. Look at verse 13. Look at this now. After they had held their peace, James answered saying, men and brethren, hearken unto me. Simeon had declared how God at the first did visit, who did he visit? Tell me out loud. Visit the Gentiles, and he says, to take out of them a people for his name. Gentiles, a people, take them out, get them to his side, and to this agree the words of the prophets in the Old Testament. To this one, the salvation of the Gentiles, the salvation of other people, to this agree the words of the prophets, as it is written, after this I will return, and I will build again the tabernacle of David, which is falling down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up, that the residue of men might seek after the Lord. And tell me the rest there. all the Gentiles, all the Gentiles, all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, says the Lord, who doeth all these things. Look at this, known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. He knew he would save us. He knew that he was interested all along from the very foundation of the world, that's God the Father, in the salvation of the whole of humanity. You know that he was involved in the calling of the greatest apostle and the greatest evangelist and the greatest teacher and the greatest pastor that ever lived. Look at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 15. Galatians chapter 1, we're looking at verse 15. He's telling us here about his call as Paul the apostle. And he says, but when it pleased who? God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, among the Gentiles, among the pagans. Immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. And so you can see his calling, the calling to be an evangelist, and the calling to be a preacher of the gospel, and the calling to be a person that will reach out to those Gentiles and heathens and pagans that were perishing. That call came from God, because this compassion to get souls saved, this compassion to get people out of darkness so that they will not have eternal punishment on them, that compassion was preeminent in the heart of the Father. And it is still preeminent today in the heart of the Father. And that's why Paul the Apostle committed himself totally to this, because he knew this was the will of God, and this is still the will of God. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, reading from verse 16. For though I preach the gospel, it says, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. If you could make that verse personal, you'll not be folding your hand. You'll rise up, you'll preach the gospel. Paul is no more here, but you are here. I said, Paul is no more here, but you are here. And what he did in those days, you will do in this day. And then it says, for if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. What is my reward then? Verily, certainly, without any shadow of doubt, that when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more. He's talking about gaining souls. He's talking about winning souls. And he says, unto the Jews, I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law, as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. To them that are without law, as without law. Being not without law to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law. To the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I made all things unto all men, that I might by all means, with all methods, with all approaches, in all possibilities, save some. It says, I do everything, so that by the grace of God, the strength of the Lord, I'll get some saved. The preeminent compassion of God the Father. We're looking at Romans chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the, what kind of gospel? I say, what kind of gospel? The gospel of God. The gospel of God. Look at verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Oh, look at this. He calls it, in verse 1, the gospel of God. Because God is involved in evangelization, in a plan of salvation, and in reaching out to the true word and the good news to the people. Because of that, it's the good news from God. It's the gospel of God. But look at verse 16. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the gospel of Christ. God the Father is involved. God the Son is involved. And it says, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're reading from verse 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 4. See the understanding and the concept of Paul the apostle concerning this preaching of the gospel. He saw it as something given to him by God the Father. Look at this. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. But as we were allowed of who? Of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God, which tries our hearts. So then we understand that as you receive the gospel and you receive the challenge to go and declare the gospel, you must be faithful to God, God the Father, because this is preeminent compassion. And we must obey God. Thank God, there's something in me that says I must obey God. I said there's something in me that says I must obey God. There's a conscience in me that says I must obey God. There's a voice of the Spirit living within, speaking from within, stirring me up and saying I must obey God. Acts of the Apostles chapter 5, verse 29. Acts of the Apostles chapter 5, verse 29. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. Looks like we should read that together. We ought to obey God rather than men. Looks like you need to say that again. Now you personally, I ought to. The preaching of the gospel is in obedience to the Lord. It's obedience to God the Father, because this is the preeminent compassion of the Father. Point number two now. In the triune God, in the triune Godhead, we have the Father, we have the Son, and we have the Holy Ghost. And they are one in unity. They never contradict each other. When the Father says go, the Son does not say, don't go. Because they are always in agreement. They are one. That's the essence of their unity. Now we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're looking at point number two, the predominant commission by God the Son. The predominant commission by God the Son. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. There's no nation that is to be excluded. I want not to say that's a closed nation. That's a closed community. That's a resistant nation. That's an unreachable nation. They are unreached, but not unreachable. Because Jesus said, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always. How long? Even unto the end of the world. Amen. And so we understand that this great commission is coming from the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and is predominant. That means it must be the real essential scene in our lives. Chapter 24 of Matthew. Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 12. Matthew chapter 24, verse 12. And because iniquity shall abound, The love of many shall wax cold. Not the love of everybody. At least I knew you there. Your own love will not wax cold. The love of many, it's talking of many outside there. It's talking of the many that turn their ears away from the truth and they are turned unto fables. It's not talking about you. It's not talking about those who are maintaining their ground in salvation and those who are maintaining their experience in sanctification and those who are maintaining the fire, rekindling the fire of the Holy Ghost within them. You will not be lukewarm. And you will not get cold. And you will not backslide in Jesus' name. It says, the love of many, I'm not among that many. I said, I'm not among that many. The love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure to the end, this is my people. And this is my group. This is where I belong. I will endure to the end. I said, I will endure to the end. Look at all that has happened since you became a believer. Maybe 5 years have gone, 10 years have gone, 15, 20, 30 years have gone. And thank God, you're still there today. The grace of God will keep you. The power of the Lord will keep you. If he has served you all these many years until this time, and you have endured until this time, much water has gone under the bridge. And many people have come and gone, but you are still there. Another year, you'll still be there. Another 5 years, you'll still be there. Another 10 years, already, you'll spend more than 10 years already. Another 10 years, you'll still be there. Until Jesus comes to take you away to your mansion, you'll still be there in Jesus' name. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. But look at this now. It says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in how many places? All the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. The end will not come until this work is done. This work will be done. Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 15. Mark chapter 16. We're reading from verse 15. It tells us here, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world. Go ye into all the world. When you reach every city, that's going to all the world. You go to every village, that's reaching all the world. You go to every local government, every province, everywhere, that is going to all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized, like many people are going to believe this weekend. I said they are going to believe this weekend. They'll hear the pure gospel, the undiluted gospel, the saving gospel from us, from you. They will believe in Jesus' name. You know, if you want people to believe, that's the way you tell somebody something, you know. If you really want the person to believe, if you want the person to doubt and feel, can it be so? Is it so? Will I be saved? Will I not be saved? That's the way you tell them. But if you want to somebody to, you are telling them so that they will believe. You are telling them persuasively. And you are telling them convincingly. And they can tell from the tone of your voice. They can tell from your posture, from your standing. They can tell from your declaration. They can tell from all the language you're using. They can tell with the face-to-face eye contact that you're having with them. They can tell with the conviction you have. They can tell from the assurance you're putting forth that this is real. Then you really want them to believe. But if you are saying something and then we can barely hear your voice and you're looking down and you're not able to look at them, you're not able to point at them, you're not able to say, I know that Jesus Christ will save you, and I know that tonight is your night, that tonight is coming your way, it's coming your way, it's going to turn around your life today. And whosoever today, I'm assuring you, whosoever today will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I'm talking to somebody, that then they raise up their hands and you say, yes, I know you are going to be saved today. The altar call is going to be made now, and when that altar call is made, you are the first one to shoot up your hand, because heaven is waiting for you. If you are convincing, then they will believe. They are going to believe. But if you are talking as if, you know, God can save. I don't know if tonight is your night. Maybe it's tonight that will be your night. I don't know. Well, the choice is yours. If you want to accept, if you want to believe, you know, if you believe, heaven is available. But if, I'm not forcing you. I'm not imposing anything on you. You know, you're not telling them the way they will believe. But you are coming to say, all the people I see here tonight, wonderful. careful. Heaven has salvation waiting for you. I said, heaven has salvation waiting for you. There's a mansion up there the Lord has prepared for you. Thank God you are going to be there. I'm going to be there. I said, I'm going to be there. And I'm going to be, and I'm not going to be there alone. You are going to be with me. We're going to be there together. You make, you talk in such a way, they will believe. I said, they will believe. That's why it says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And he, but he that believeth not shall be damned. You see the great commission here. We're looking at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, and I'm reading from verse 45. Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 45. Then open he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures. We will understand the scriptures. And the people we're talking to, we're preaching to, will understand the gospel in Jesus' name. In verse 46, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behoved Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. You see, that's the Lord Jesus Christ talking. And he says, we shall preach this repentance everywhere. In obedience to him, we're going to do it. I said, we're going to do it. And look at the apostles, how they did it. And look at the early church, how they did it. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, reading from verse 27. Acts chapter 5, verse 27. And when they had brought them, they brought them forth. They set them before the council. And the high priest asked them, saying, did not we strictly charge you, command you, that ye should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem. We're going to fill this city with the gospel. There are going to be converts in every house in this city in Jesus' name. In this city, in this state, as you knock at this door, there's a deeper life member there. As you go to the slum area, there's a deeper life person there. As you go to the highbrow area, there's a deeper life person there. We're going to fill the stage with the word of God and with the witnesses of the gospel in Jesus' name. Didn't we strictly charge you that you should not teach in this name? And behold, ye have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, and intend to bring this man's blood upon us. Then Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to be God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him as God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are his witnesses. Were the witnesses of these things, and so also is the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them that obey him. I'm one of those people that obey him. I said, I'm one of those people that obey him. You'll keep on obeying in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles chapter 18, we're reading from verse 9. Acts chapter 18, and we're reading from verse 9. Acts 18, reading from verse 9, is the predominant commission that Christ himself has given to the whole church and has given to you. Acts 18, verse 9, then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak. Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. This weekend, especially, we're going out to preach the word. You will not be afraid. You will speak. You will declare it everywhere you are. And all the people in that community, they'll be hearing that word will be taken by the Holy Ghost, will arrest everyone in Jesus' name. And they will not be able to resist the power of your word, the pungency of your word, and the drawing the pull of your word. And God said, be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee. Will he be with you?
Yes.
The Almighty, will he be with you?
Yes.
The creator of the heavens and the earth, will he be with you?
Yes.
The one that never lost a battle, will he be with you? And the one that has power to heal and power to deliver, will he be with you?
Yes.
Healings will take place.
Deliverances
will take place. Miracles will take place, because he said, "For I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee."
Amen.
Did I hear an amen there?
Amen.
No man, magical man, nobody. Occultic man, nobody. Evil man, nobody. And the people that feel all the surrounding, and they are doing whatever, raising up whatever, they are shouting whatever, whatever shout you hear, it is outside the territory of the crusade ground. Because it says, "And no man shall hurt thee, for I have much people in this city." Look at verse 11, and he continued there a year and 6 months. This one we're doing this weekend is just a first start. It's the beginning. Another few months after, we're going to do it again. A few months after, we're going to do it again, until everybody in this stage will hear the word in Jesus' name. And he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. It's very clear from the word of God that this is the supreme responsibility of the whole church. It is the predominant commission of the church from Christ our Savior, Christ our Lord, Christ our Master. What's he telling us? Reach the unreached. Reach the unreached. What's he telling us? Seek the unsought. The people that have, they don't understand the gospel. Nobody has sought them to give them the gospel. Seek the unsought. What's he telling us? Snatch them from Satan. Snatch them from Satan. Don't let Satan own them, keep them, and take them to hell. Snatch them from Satan. Deliver them from death and hell. They are rushing on to death, and they are rushing on to hell. You can stop that rush, and you can deliver them from death and from hell. Go after the godless. Run after them. Go after them and reach out to them and pull them out of the destruction they are going into. Let not them perish. Let them not perish. Pursue them. Pursue them. It's like, you know that that's your target. You know that that's somebody Jesus died for. It's straying away. Pursue them. Not only that, you preach to them. Preach to them. Tell them the word. And not only this weekend, every time as you pursue them, you preach to them. Pray for them. Pray for them that God will soften their hearts. God will open their hearts. God will make them listen to the word of God, and they will incline their ears to the word of God. Plead with them. Plead with them. It's like you're begging them. You're like a salesman. They must get this thing. They must have this thing. They must possess this thing. You persuade them. You speak persuasively. You speak convincingly. Not only that, you prevail on them until they yield, until they give themselves. You're not going to leave them alone. Prevent them from hell. Prevent them from hell. Preserve them for heaven. When you get to heaven, you'll see multitudes that will get to heaven because of you. Because of your preaching. And for all eternity, every time they see you walking across the golden state, they say, "Hi, hello there, I'm grateful God used you to bring me here. Why not for you, I will not have been here." For all eternity, somebody is reminding you. They meet you that corner, and they say, "Thank you very much, you are faithful to God. That weekend, do you remember? I was there. I was just a curious person, and I came there, and the way you were standing, the way you were talking, and you pointed at me like this, you caught me. And here am I now in heaven." You'll have testimonies following after you in heaven, in Jesus' name. prevent them from hell, preserve them for heaven. This is the all important work to do. This is the most important work and ministry from Christ to dispersed members. We're dispersed everywhere. We're not just in one place, and to dedicated ministers of the gospel. There's no other assignment as important as this. This is more important than gaining the whole world. Because what will it profit a man if that man gains the whole world and he loses his own soul, and he loses the soul he shall bring unto the Lord? Therefore, you will obey the Lord, and your life will be dedicated to preaching the word with Jesus as Savior, Lord, and Master, as given unto us. You will not fail. You will not fail. And this word will be powerful through you to convert many people and bring them into the kingdom in Jesus' name. Point number three now, the prevailing confirmation of God, the Holy Ghost. You know what you are learning here? God the Father has compassion, and it's a preeminent compassion because of the people who are perishing, so that they will know the Lord, they will turn to the Lord, they will leave the path of sin, and they'll come to the salvation of the Lord. But it's not only that God the Father has this compassion, the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, also has this predominant commission that he has given to us. And now the Holy Ghost has the confirmation, prevailing confirmation of God, the Holy Ghost. Let's see that this sending forth is also by the Holy Ghost. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 2. Acts chapter 13, verse 2. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." Were they not doing some work before this time? This one takes the preeminence. Were they not trained to be tent makers and to have this and that? This one takes the first place. Were they not sent? Were they not doing something? Assignment and duty and responsibility before this time? This one takes a higher value, a more important place. And this one is now the essential scene. If they have to give up something, they have to give them up. If they have to abandon any other thing, they have to abandon that thing. Because the Holy Ghost now is saying, there is a work to do. There's an assignment to carry out. There's a responsibility they must get involved with. And he says, "Separate them unto me." And he mentioned them by name. And he said, "This is the work they must do now." I pray you will hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. You know, there are many people that go through life, they say, "I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian." They never hear the audible, distinct, convincing voice of the Holy Spirit. They're just like there. If they feel like speaking to this person, they speak to him. If they feel like evangelizing, they evangelize. But they don't have any convincing call that they will say, "The Holy Ghost spoke to me and he said, this is what to do." Abandon every other sin, jettison every other sin, forsake every other sin, because the Holy Ghost has now said, "This is what to do." I pray that in your heart, in your inner man, in your soul, in your spirit, the Lord will speak distinctly and convincingly. And you will know that this is what he has raised you up for in Jesus' name. As they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, "Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them." And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Look at verse 4. So they being sent forth by who? Tell me out loud. Sent forth by the Holy Ghost, departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus, because it's now the Holy Ghost that sent them forth. The Lord is telling us that as we go, we should not be afraid of, what am I going to say? What if I open my mouth? What am I going to tell the people? The Holy Ghost will give you the utterance. Because it's the Holy Ghost that sends you forth, and he gives you all the instruments and all the weapon, and he gives you all the wherewithal that you use when you get there, and your words will not fail you. I said, words will not fail you. It brings to your remembrance what you should say, what you should speak, and many will turn to the Lord in Jesus' name. Mark chapter 13, verses 10 and 11. Mark chapter 13, verses 10 and 11. You see the part of the Holy Ghost as we go forth and preach the gospel. It says in verse 10, and the gospel must first be published where? Among all nations. The gospel must first be published, proclaimed and preached and declared among all nations. Look at verse 11. Immediately he said that. He said, but when they shall lead you and deliver you up, take no thought beforehand what ye shall speak, neither do ye premeditate, but whatsoever shall be given to you in that hour, that speak ye, for it is not ye that speak. Tell me who's speaking? For the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost. It says as you go out like that, just pray and say, Lord, I know you have sent me. The Holy Ghost, I know you have sent me forth. And because you have sent me forth, you'll give me the word, he'll give you the word. I said he'll give you the word. In Luke chapter 12, I'm reading from verses 11 and 12. Luke chapter 12, 11 and 12. We go forth and we're declaring the word. We go forth and we're declaring the truth. We go forth and we're telling the good news. We go forth and we're telling the gospel of salvation, the gospel that saves, and the gospel that transforms people's lives, that changes people's lives, the gospel that solves their problems, the gospel that breaks the yokes of their lives. And we're not alone, but the power of the Holy Ghost is with us. That power will not fail you. I said that power will not fail you. The Holy Ghost will give you utterance. The Holy Ghost will give you understanding. And the Holy Ghost will give you the persuasive words and the pungency that will get right to the hearts of the people. In Luke chapter 12, verses 11 and 12. Luke 12, verse 11. It says, and when they bring you unto the synagogue, and unto the magistrates, and unto the powers, take ye no thought how or what things ye shall answer, or what he shall say. For verse 12, 1, 2, 3, go everybody. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in the same hour what ye ought to say. If you claim that, it will be true in your life. I said it will be true in your life. When you are to preach the gospel for somebody to actually, he knows their heart, he knows their understanding, he knows their dullness, he knows their level, and whatever you are to speak to them, so that this particular one will be convinced, he will give you the right word for this particular one. In every location where you are, the Holy Ghost knows the states and the minds of the people who are there, and the right word at the right time to the right person that will send forth a convincing word that they will be saved, he'll give unto you in Jesus' name. And when you have to pray for the sick, he knows the sickness is there, he knows the kind of word you speak that will generate faith in their heart, he'll give you that word, and you speak that word and pray in the name of Jesus, they're going to get healed in Jesus' name. He knows the people that have gotten involved with occultic power, occultic kind of covenant, and he knows all the things that, you know, they're hiding us under. He knows the refuge of lies that they're hiding under, and he knows them, and he knows what you're going to say. He'll put the word in your mouth, and that word will be like hammer, that word like a sword, it will be like fire, it will burn all the refuge of lies in Jesus' name. That's why it says in that verse 12, for the Holy Ghost shall teach you in the same hour, in the same hour, in the same hour, what he ought to say. And when you say what he once said, when you say what he has put in your mind, when you say what he has put in your spirit, it will get to the right target, and it will knock them down, and you'll give their lives to the Lord in Jesus' name. I want you to look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, Acts of of the Apostles chapter 4 and see the ministry of the Holy Spirit as we go forth, and we're going forth in preaching and evangelizing. You understand what we're saying? This compassion to reach out to souls is by the Father, and this commission to reach out to souls is by the Son, and this confirmation reach out to souls is by the Holy Ghost. We're looking at Acts chapter 4. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, I'm reading here from verse 8. Look at what verse 8 is saying. Then Peter, being filled, tell me, with the Holy Ghost. He had been baptized in the Holy Ghost before, but now he came to a challenge. And the people asked him, and they said, by what authority, by what name are you doing this? And at that very moment, at the moment of need, the Holy Ghost will possess you. He will endure you, and he will empower you. He will energize you, and you'll say what you ought to say in Jesus' name. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and the elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to this impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all. How many people? Be it known unto you, how many people? Unto all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified. Look at Peter, the timid man. Look at Peter, this fearful man. Look at Peter, this trembling man. He looked at them now, the Holy Ghost has come. And when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, all that timidity will vanish away. All the trembling will vanish away. And all the fear of man that closes your eyes, the fear of man that gives you palpitation in the heart, the fear of man that makes you to tremble, all that fear of man will vanish away. This weekend, there is no fear. I said this weekend, there's no timidity. You stand in the strength of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, and you declare this word, mighty oaks will come down. Mighty giants will come down. They will be slain by the word of God, and they will be drawn into the kingdom in Jesus' name. He said, be it known unto you all, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught by you builders, which has become the hedge of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other. Is this Peter talking? Yes, it's Peter. It's a changed man. It's a changed minister. And then as we look at you this weekend, that's brother so-and-so. That's minister so-and-so. That's pastor so-and-so. Because a new day has come. A new era has come. And the power of God will speak through you in Jesus' name. And Peter declared, neither is there salvation in any other. For there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Now, when they saw, they will see something. When they saw, they will see it in you. I said they'll see it in you. When they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and they perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, wonder of all wonders. They'll wonder this weekend. They'll be surprised this weekend. The power of God will go through you and penetrate every heart through you in Jesus' name. And they took knowledge of them that been with Jesus. They'll take knowledge of you. Let's come to verse 31. In verse 31, look at verse 31. And when they had preached, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with what? With who? With the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God. How? With boldness. They speak the word of God with boldness. Acts of the Apostles chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, and we're reading from verse 6. Acts of the Apostles chapter 13, reading from verse 6. And when they had gone through the isle unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer. They're always there. Will conquer them. and a false prophet, they are there, but will overcome them. A Jew whose name was by Jesus, which was the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of God. But Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, withstood them. Don't be afraid when they withstand you. Don't be afraid when they confront you. Don't be afraid when they challenge you. Withstood them, seeking to turn the deputy from the faith. Then Saul, who also is called Paul, filled, tell me, well, the Holy Ghost set his eyes on him. Don't look down. Don't look sideways. Don't look that other side. Don't look as if you are distracted. Don't look as if you know you are afraid to look at them. Eyeball to eyeball, fire will come from your eyes that will penetrate into their lives in Jesus' name. Then Paul, who is also called Paul, or Saul, called Paul, filled with the Holy Ghost, set his eyes on him and said, he didn't plan this before. This one was not in his outline. This one was not in his notes. This one, the Holy Ghost gave this one at that very time. That's what I'm telling you. He'll give you something beyond your notes. It's good to prepare notes. It's good to prepare a guiding outline. But you know, you're not just going to keep reading that outline and reading the notes, and then there is nothing coming from the Holy Ghost. There's something coming from heaven. There's something coming from the Holy Ghost beyond what you have in the notes. And that thing, when it comes from the Holy Ghost and comes through your mouth, will penetrate their hearts and will send all those schemers and all those subtle people, he'll send them away in Jesus' name. And said, O full of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to prevent, to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, this was not in his note. This one is impromptu. This was not in his note. This was given by the Holy Ghost at that time, for that moment, and for this reason. And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind. He didn't think of this before. He didn't premeditate this before. This is the word of the Holy Ghost coming through him, and not see the sun for a season. And immediately, everybody say immediately. God will not waste time. Immediately you say the word, there'll be a confirmation. There'll be a fulfillment. And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, he believed, and being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. The time has come. Paul has done his own. He lived his own time. This is your time. And you're going to live, you're going to have a fulfilled and fulfilling ministry, even at this your time, in Jesus' name. The Holy Ghost empowers us. The Holy Ghost enables us. The Holy Ghost emboldens us. The Holy Ghost enlists us. The Holy Ghost engages us. And the Holy Ghost enlightens us. The Holy Ghost endues us and endows us. And he tells us, this is the way, walk ye therein. He has called you. He has called me. He has empowered you. He has empowered me. He has emboldened me. He has emboldened you. He has enlisted you among the ministers that are to preach the gospel. And he's engaging you, saying, this, maybe this is your first time that you're standing as an evangelist. This is an engagement from the Holy Ghost himself. He's endowing you this weekend. Endowing you this weekend, so that you will declare the word of God. He will confirm the word. He will strengthen you. He will support you. He will walk inside you. He will walk through you. And the only thing is that you must obey the call of the Spirit. And this is the time of obedience. It's the time of faithfulness. It's the time of commitment and consecration to the great commission the Lord has given us. Obedience is rewardable. Disobedience is reprovable. Faithfulness is profitable. Unfaithfulness is punishable. And consecration, commitment is commendable. Carelessness, careless, free person that I don't know whether I want to do it now or not. Carelessness is condemnable. Here is your time to be obedient. I'll be obedient. It's your time to be faithful. I'll be faithful. And it's your time to be committed and consecrated. I'll be committed. Look at how dull the voice is. You're going to... Okay, we're going to start again. I will be obedient. I was not disobedient to that heavenly vision. I will be faithful. I will be committed. I will be consecrated. God will use you for his glory. And God will bring many people into the kingdom through you. Where are you there? I say, where are you there? Why don't you stand up and tell the Lord, your time has come. Time of profitability. And time of responsibility. And time to be useful. And time to bring many into the kingdom of God. He will use you. He will use you. Raise your voice so the Lord prepare, prepare, prepare. He wants to use you. And bring many souls into the kingdom through you. Your time has come. You'll be profitable in the kingdom.